Now I want you to know that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, I am in chains for Christ.
Of a series that we are, it's called the Book of Philippians. We're doing it on a book of the Bible. And what I like to do every year as a pastor and as a leader is to take one series that we do throughout the year and look at a book of the Bible and get to know our Bibles just a little bit better. And so if you were with us last week, you've learned that this book was written by the Apostle Paul, who wrote a lot of the New Testament. And Paul wrote this letter to a church in the city of Philippi. And he wrote them this letter to encourage them, to help them, some of the things they're going through. And at the same time, though, Paul had some great dreams in his life. Like, I don't know about you, but if you had some great dreams, some bucket list things that you want to do, Paul had some bucket list things that he wanted to do. And one of his dreams was to go to Rome one day and to stand on a stage in Rome and preach to tens of thousands of people and share the love of God with folks and just see thousands of people come to know Christ. That's something that he wanted to do. And so Paul was in Rome at this time that he's writing this letter, but he wasn't on a stage preaching to anybody. He was actually in a prison cell. Paul had gotten arrested while he was in Jerusalem, and he was just a Jesus follower, and actually because he actually cast out a demon out of some people, and people got mad about it, and he was following Christ, and so they arrested him because of this, and then they sent him on a journey all the way to Rome, and now he was standing to wait trial, and while he's waiting trial, he's writing these letters to these great churches, and he's encouraging them, and so everything that we're reading, everything we're talking about this month, Paul writes these letters, these words from a prison cell. The prisons were a lot different than they are up here today. Back then, they were probably underground, dark and cold, you know, no sunlight, worst place imaginable. And Paul writes these letters to this Philippian church. And his overarching theme in the entire letter is how to have joy in the midst of any circumstance. How to have joy no matter what. If you were with us last week, we talked about how, you know, it's important to, if you want to have joy, to stop asking God, why? Why me, God? Why am I going through this? Why is it always happening to me, God? And stop asking him why and start asking him what? Like, God, what do you want me to do? God, what are you trying to teach me through this? What areas of my heart still need to be surrendered to you, God? Like what in the world are you trying to do in me? And when we take that perspective, things begin to change when we're going through situations, because we can gain something out of the midst of any difficult time, any circumstance that we walk through. And so today we're going to jump into chapter 2. We're going to work through the book of this book of the Bible, chapter by chapter. There's only 4 chapters in this book. So if you want to go home today and read it, it'll probably take you 10, maybe 15 minutes. And you can brag to all your friends that you read a book of the Bible. And you don't have to tell them which one, but just, I read a book of the Bible, and everyone will be so impressed. All right, we're going to jump right into chapter 2 today. starting off in verse 15, about halfway through the chapter, and Paul says this. He goes, but you are living with crooked and mean people all around you. And everybody said a real loud amen. No, don't say amen too loud. Somebody around you might get offended. But Paul says, listen, you're living with people in this world today that are mean and they're crooked and there are people all around you that are like this. And I don't know, it's kind of like, we talked about this last week, that there's a difference between happiness and joy. Like happiness is what the world has. Happiness is based on happenings. So if everything's going great, if everything's perfect in your life, then you can have happiness. And people call it joy, but it's an emotion that's really just simply happiness. Because what happens, we learn through the word of God, is that only true joy comes out of a relationship that's rooted in Christ. So what happens all the time is when people go through difficult times, when they don't have Christ in their life, they have this thing called happiness, but happiness goes away based on circumstance, and then they have nothing left to sustain them through the difficult situation. And that's why we need joy in our life. It's easy at the same time when you don't know Christ to follow your sinful nature, to do whatever you think is best, and to live a life that is far from God. And Paul says, he goes, listen, I see this, that you can live around people that are mean. You can live around some grouchy people at times. There's people that are crooked in this world. You're living around all these people. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel like when I leave my house and I go out in the morning and try to mind my own business, have a good day, it seems like I can bump into some mean and grouchy people in this world. I don't know if you ever have before, but it's like you can bump into some people. I was a couple months ago, I was driving down to Birmingham, and I pulled into this parking lot. I needed to run into a store real quick. And this parking lot, you know, I'm trying to find a parking spot. And I know all the people of this church. You guys are amazing drivers. So like the information I'm about to tell you, like you get it. Because you guys are awesome. You guys understand like the concepts when you drive and parking lot. Like it, you get it. And so if you drive into a parking lot, there's some parking lots that when you go down a lane, they're one way. There's just one way. Like we know this because the spots are slanted a little bit, so it's easier to pull in. And then they have these really huge arrows that are painted into the asphalt, so you know it's probably a one way in this lane right here. And so I'm looking for a parking spot. It's a beautiful day. Got my window down. I'm going down the one-way lane, and as I get to the end of the lane, looking for a parking spot, I'm looking to my left, I'm looking to my right, and there's this lady who's trying to turn down my one-way lane. And she's probably, you know, she's probably the sweetest old lady. She's about the age of my grandma, you know, and I'm looking at her, and I'm like, okay, what are you trying to do? And she looks at me, and then for whatever reason, she proceeds to tell me that I am number one in her life. And I'm like, what did I do? And so I pull up a little bit further. She rolls her window down. I mean, like, well, she rolled her window down. This, if you're in the 80s, you know what I'm talking about. She rolled her window down, and she proceeded to tell me how much of a horrible person I am, and she just cussed me out like you would not believe. Like, I'm looking at her, and I'm like, what in the world is going on? Why are you so angry? What's going on? Like, grandma, why are you so mad right now? I don't understand. Like I'd never seen somebody that was so angry, and I had no clue what I had done wrong. I had no idea what was going on. I was just totally bewildered. And the reality is, sometimes you're going to encounter people in the world that are messed up, that are angry, that are crooked, that are not going to be very nice to you. And what I've learned in my life, you can jot this down if you're taking notes this morning, and that is, you can't decide how people treat you, but you can decide how you respond. You can't decide who's going to be nice to you, who's going to love you, who's going to accept your friend request on Facebook. Like, you can't decide who's going to be nice to you, who's going to be mean to you, who's going to be aggressive towards you. You can't decide that, but what you can decide is how you respond in the midst of every situation. Philippians 2:15, Paul goes on and he says this. He goes, but you are living with crooked and mean people all around you, among whom you shine like stars in the dark world. I love that. He says, listen, He goes, we as Jesus followers, we should shine like stars in a world that is dark. Here's my problem, though. A lot of times when I grew up in church, I don't know about you, I grew up in church. I always was here in a church of some setting. But my problem was that when I grew up in church, it was like the church people that I was around weren't very nice people. They were actually very, very ornery and angry people. Like I was with people who, we were against everything. We loved Jesus, but we were against the world. We were against culture. We were against everything. Like we didn't know what we were for more than we knew what we were against. Like we were against people, and we would call people out that never encountered Christ, that never understood that there's a God who loves them. And we would, oh man, they're sinners and they're going to hell and all this stuff. And it was just so mean at times that we had forgotten that Jesus says, you know, hey, love your neighbor as much as you love yourself. Like that's a huge principle in Christianity. And what I've seen so often is that we forgot the love aspect of this. And it's great to have a moral guide. We look at the Bible as our moral guide. The boundaries are clear in what God wants us to do in our lives. And it's so awesome and it's so wonderful. And it gives freedom to everybody. And the world needs this because it's the lawsuit who need the freedom, and God will do a great thing in our life. But man, if we are a church that doesn't have love, if we're people that don't shine in darkness, that we are people that are just as angry as the world, then we blend in just like everybody else. Like I've talked to people who would say, you know, hey, you know what? Well, you're just as angry as I am, even though you're a Christian. Like, you're just as mad. You maybe are mad at other things that are different than what I'm mad about, but you're just as mad as things that I'm mad about. I see what you post on Facebook. I see the things you're yelling about. And you say that I need Jesus, and yet you just act and look just like me. I don't get it. And Paul says, no. We need to embrace something different. We need to embrace this idea of joy in the midst of any circumstance, in every circumstance. And at the same time that it gives us, how we live our life, gives us an opportunity to shine in a world that is dark and that needs the love of God. So what I want to do today is I want to talk to you about relationships and how we can do that in every relationship that we engage in. How do we live for God? How do we be nice to people? How do we find joy in the midst of being around people that can be mean and can hurt us and can be grouchy at times? How can we do this in our life? And Paul talks about this. So if you're taking notes today, I got 3 points because preachers speak in threes. So I don't know what it is, but we got 3 points all the time. But first of all, Philippians 2:3 says this. Paul says, listen, when you do things, do not let selfishness or pride be your guide. So Paul starts off and he says, if you want to have good relationships, if you want to shine in this dark world, then you have to check your motivation at the door. You got to check selfishness and pride. So if you're taking notes today, the first thing that we got to look at and begin to investigate in our own lives is our motivation. Number one, motivation. Like, what is our motivation when it comes to the world that we're living in? If we're gonna be a Christ followers in this generation, if we're gonna love people, if we're gonna shine like stars in a dark world, then our motivation needs to be pure in every relationship that we engage in. Now, it's natural for us to be selfish and to be prideful. I think ever since birth, as humans, we are the center of our own universe. Like, we depend on our parents for everything. We want them to fulfill every need that we have. And as we get older, the sign of maturity is that it wouldn't be about us anymore, but about others as well. And so it's easy, though, that as we get older, that this selfishness and pride still creeps into our life and wants to dominate us. I'll prove it to you. If you were at a, let's say, a wedding or a gathering, and all your friends are together and you're hanging out, and somebody snapped a picture, a group photo of you guys, like when you see the photo, who's the first person you're looking for in that photo? Yourself, let's be honest. You're looking for yourself. And then what makes that picture a good picture or not? How you look in that picture, come on. How you look in it. Like if you are blinking, but everybody else is looking great, you're like, oh my goodness, horrible picture. Please delete it right now. Like just get it out of here. I don't wanna ever see that picture again. But like, if you look good in the picture, but yet maybe your best friend looks like they're picking their nose or something in the photo, like you're like, oh my goodness, this is a great picture. This is the best one ever. I'm gonna put it on Facebook and I'm gonna make sure and tag you in it so everyone else sees that you look like you're picking your nose. That's how we live our lives, and we let selfishness kind of creep in, and we wanna be the center of our universe. But the whole concept of Christianity is that we remove ourselves from the center and we place Christ in the center of our lives, and that others would be even more important than our own selves, and that we would live our lives for others, is not just for our own self. And that's what Christianity is all about. But we all have friendships in our life who actually we wanna hang around with this people that just like what we like. We can live our lives in a way where we say, you know what, I only want to hang out with people who want to go to the same restaurants that we like. We're only going to go to the same, hang out with people that watch the same movies that we like. We're only going to hang out with people that want to do the things that we want to do. And if you don't want to do the things that I don't want to do, then maybe I'm busy on that night and I can't hang out with you. And so we're going to not hang out as much because I want to do what I want to do. That's just it. And what I've learned in my life too, if you're taking notes, you can write this down, that if all of our relationships are based on selfishness, then all of our relationships will be shallow. It's just gonna be. They will be shallow because the depth of relationships is based in, is all about sacrifice for others, what you do for other people. Paul teaches us how to do this in verse 3. He says, when you do things, do not let selfishness or pride be your guide. Instead, be humble and give more honor to others than yourself. This is kind of a two-step process in this whole idea. He goes, we want humility and honor to be really what is your guide. Not selfishness and pride, but humility and honor. And humility is simply just lowering yourself, like not thinking too highly of yourself, understanding that you have flaws in yourself and in your life, and lowering yourself. And then and honor is actually elevating other people. Like when you elevate other people, you speak the best of them, you believe the best in them, you think the best of them, you elevate them in your life. And so Paul says, don't be the center of your universe. Instead, think less of yourself and let other people be elevated all around you. This is a constant process of taking the lower position in relationships and elevating other people. And Paul tells us again how to do this in verse 4. He says, do not be interested only in your own life, but be interested in the lives of others. I think this is great as Americans because we need this as Americans. I don't know, maybe you've never experienced this, but maybe if you ever had somebody that maybe you went out to coffee with or lunch with, and for the entire lunch conversation, like all they do is talk about themselves. Like they just talk and talk and talk about themselves. They don't even take a breath. They're talking about themselves, the stuff they're doing, their marriage, their kids, their relationships, their job, their this, their that. And you're like, oh my goodness. And they don't even take a breath. And for the whole conversation, like they haven't even touched their sandwich because they're talking about themselves so much. And then when they do stop, they say things, something like, you know, well, hey, enough about me. What do you think about me? You know, they want to know what you think about that. And it's like, oh my goodness. It's like, oh, like we've all maybe had conversations with people or seen people like this. And Paul says, wait, like think of others before you think of yourself. The whole concept of Christianity, like I said, is removing ourselves and allowing other people to be elevated in our own life. Paul says, do you want to shine like stars in a dark world? Then begin to actually think of other people higher than yourself. Like, be interested in the lives of other people. If you do this and you start being interested in the lives of other people, like you will become everybody's best friend. Because very few people are in this world actually take that posture and are interested in the lives of other people. So how do we do this? Like, if you're in a conversation with somebody, like engage in the conversation. Ask them questions. Like, ask them questions that go even deeper. Ask them what they're going through. What's going on in their life? What's happening? What are they excited about? What are they dreaming about? What are they worried about? What is the weight that they're carrying? And when you do this, you'll become everybody's best friend, because the world that we live live in doesn't operate like this. We can't wait to get in and turn the conversation back towards us. Let me tell you what I'm doing. Let me tell you what I did yesterday. Let me tell you this. And when you do this and you begin to keep the conversation on them and show genuine interest in the lives of other people, you're gonna be everybody's favorite person, because nobody in this world lives this way, because it's all about other people. And what I found too is when we begin to turn our perspective towards others, it changes the way we view other people. You can jot this down when you're taking notes too, and that is, don't think about how they hurt you, but think about why they hurt you. Like if somebody hurts you in your life and your perspective begins to change based on what God's word, all of a sudden you stop thinking about how they hurt me, what they did to me, but you start thinking about why they actually hurt me. When you're interested in others, it changes all of a sudden. You start to think deeper about that person. And all of a sudden you start to realize that wait, selfishness and pride's response when I'm hurt is, how dare you talk to me this way? How dare you, think you can come at me like this? You know, who do you think you are? Like selfishness and pride's response is like that. But what happens is later is you start to respond differently when you take genuine interest in the life of somebody else. After I got cussed out in the parking lot, man, I was pretty heated. I was pretty upset. I was like, what did I do? I didn't do anything wrong. I know I'm in the right. And as I allowed pride and selfishness to slowly decrease in my life, and as I drove away, because sometimes you just need to drive away, come on somebody. And I drove away and I'm just like, you know what, I can't believe this. And I started to think about this lady. And I started to think about what just happened, and it did not make sense to me. What was going on? I started thinking, I wonder what this poor woman has gone through in her life, that just by seeing me in a parking lot, maybe she thought I was doing something wrong, but set her off in such a degree of anger that she totally lost it. I mean, what in the world, what hurt is this lady dealing with that it was that quick to just lose it on somebody, a complete stranger? Who's hurt her in her life that all of a sudden she would respond to me, a complete stranger, driving a big old truck, by the way, that could run her over in her car? No, I wouldn't do that. But anyway, but like, why would she do this? I started thinking about this, that maybe there's something deeper at play in this lady's life that I would never ever know. What if she just left the doctor's office and got a horrible response? What if someone she loved just had a horrible diagnosis? What if something in her life is going on and the issue that I'm seeing really isn't the issue, but there's something deeper there in my life? I'm not thinking about how they hurt me, but I'm thinking about, okay, why in the world are they hurt me? What might she be going through? And if you live from that perspective, then you don't take things personally. Because we can take things personally all the time. Oh my gosh, I'm taking this so personally what they said, but maybe, just maybe, there's something else at play in that person's life that's causing them to react the way that they reacted to you. And when you say, okay, maybe there's something else, but why did they hurt me this way? Your perspective changes and you begin to not take things personally and you begin to shine like stars in a dark world. And Paul says this, he goes, no, we need to live like Jesus. And he says, in your relationships, verse 5, with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. He made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant. I love that, because if anybody who ever walked on the face of this planet had the right to demand things from people, it would have been Jesus. But in every conversation, in every situation, in every moment, he lowered himself and he lifted other people up all the time. He called out greatness in people. He washed people's feet. He led as a servant. He led as a greatest leader. And he showed us what it means to truly be a servant in every aspect. And because of this, he made a difference all around him in the world that he was living in. And so God has called us to live a life that is completely different than what society and culture will say. If you want to shine like stars in this dark world, then it says, listen, then check your motivation. Don't let selfishness and pride be your guide, but instead live a life of honor and humility, actually lowering yourself, lifting other people up, believing the best in other people, thinking differently about that situation and realizing that maybe there's something deeper at play in someone else's heart. My motivation is changing. My motivation is changing. Well, how do we actually do this? How do we get our motivation to change? Because it's easy to want to be selfish. It's easy to want to revert back to our own prideful ways. And Paul tells us how to do this in verse 12. He goes on and says, therefore, my dear friends, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. So the way we change our motivation is through a process. Number two, if you're taking notes today, called sanctification. Sanctification. Now, sanctification is a big Bible word that I've found that most people in our culture don't really know or understand what this word means anymore. So let me give you a simple definition of sanctification, and that's this. Sanctification is the process of working out what God is working in. Working out, so God's working inside of you, and we're working out what God is placing on the inside of that. God is working in the inside of every single one of us. When you come to Christ and you give your life to Him and you get saved, like we talk about, your eternity is secure in Christ. But then we all have issues that we're working through. We all got stuff. We all got issues. If you don't think you got issues, then that's your issue, just so you know, okay? Like, we all have issues that we're working through, that we're working towards. And Jesus says, listen, I want to come into your life. I want to do a work on the inside of you. And then eventually it's going to start to come out of you where other people are going to start to notice that you're not the same person you were before Christ, that there's something on the inside working and changing you and being different in you, constantly allowing Christ to work on the inside of you. The other day, my son was putting some Lego sets together. I love Legos. I love my son. He loves Legos. That means I get to play with Legos again as a 38-year-old man, and it's just joyous. That brings joy to my life. But my son's putting Legos together the other day, and he's like, Dad, I can't figure this out. Can you help me? And I'm like, sure, son, I can help you, absolutely. And he continued to work on it on his own. And I'm like, son, do you want help? He's like, yeah, okay, give it to me. He's like, okay, yeah, Dad. And he like refused to give it to me. He's like, he wants help, but he's still doing it on his own. And I'm like, son, I go, if you want help, you gotta put it in Dad's hands. Like, I'm not gonna take it from you, I love you. If you want help, you gotta put it in Dad's hands. He's like, okay, oh yeah, Dad, I need help. And he kept fussing with it and trying to figure out on his own. And I'm just sitting there laughing, and I'm like, I'm gonna use this in a message one day. And finally, he like had this defeated look like, oh, okay, Dad, here. And he put it in my hand, and I looked at it, and it was all messed up. Like I'm an instructions guy. And I was like, it is nothing like the instructions. Dad is here, let me fix this for you. Maybe get some super glue out so you never can break it again. And I'm thinking about this, and it's like, how many of us are reluctant to put all of our life, every aspect of our life, in the hands of God? We're like, oh my God, God, I need your help. God, I need your help with this situation, with my relationship, with my finances. God, I need you to help me with this job opportunity. God, I need you to help me. But we're reluctant to put all of our life, every aspect of our life, in His hands. We want to continue to fuss with it on our own. We want to continue to do it on our own. And God's saying, listen, I want to do a work inside of you. I want to continue to do something great inside of you. But you got to give me all of your life. I can only do with what you give me. And if you only give me a little portion of your life, then only a little portion of your life is gonna see change and gonna see freedom. But if you give me all of your life, you give me every aspect of everything, then you're gonna begin to see the freedom and the joy that you've been longing for your entire life. So we continue to allow God to work out something that He's doing on the inside of us. I love what James even says in chapter 4, the brother of Jesus says, do you know where your fights and arguments come from? And some of you may be thinking, yeah, the jerk I'm married to, right? Or my neighbor with those crazy barking dogs that bark all the time, or my boss. Yeah, it's my boss. That's where my fights and arguments come from. And James says, no, that's not where they come from. In fact, they come from selfish desires that war within you. And there's something going on in the inside that is a fight. And what I realized too is this, you can jot this down as well. People don't create my problems, they display my problems. Like, people don't create my problems, they just display the issues and the problems that I'm still dealing with. Like, I didn't create that lady's problem that day in the parking lot. For whatever reason, I was just a trigger that when she saw me, she thought I was maybe doing something wrong. I still don't know what I did wrong. When I get to heaven, I'm gonna ask God, what did I do wrong in that place right there? I don't know. But when she was so mad at me, and I was just a trigger for something that was a deeper wound in her life at that point. I didn't create the problem. I was just a trigger for the problem. I just displayed the problem for whatever reason. At the same time, when we lose it on somebody, we can lose it on people. We can lose it on our spouse. We can lose it on our kids. We can lose it on our coworkers or somebody around us, a family member. When we lose it on somebody, it just shows us and it indicates to me that, I mean, God still needs to do a work on the inside of me. That I still need to give God every aspect of my life. I said there's areas that maybe I'm holding back and I gotta give him more access to because I don't wanna just chew out my wife. I don't wanna yell at my kids. I don't wanna be that guy. And so I need God to do a work on the inside of me. And I thank God so much that he does this in Philippians chapter 2, verse 13. He says, for God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him. I love that because God says, listen, when you come to him and you give your life to him, he doesn't just leave you how you are, but he does a work on the inside of you, but he gives you the desire and the power to do the things that he's calling you to do, the things that you want to do, but you just don't know how to do. And I thank God for that because I need his strength, his wisdom to do the things that he's called me to do. I need his power to overcome selfishness and pride. I need him to do a work inside of me because where I am is not where I want to be, but where God is taking me is where I want to go to. And I believe that God wants to do something on the work on the inside of us to say, listen, I want to work on your motivation. I want to do a sanctification process in you, taking you further and deeper into the things of God so you're not going to stay the same because I want you to shine like stars in this dark world. I want you to make a difference in this world. And that's what I love about God because when you come to him, you may not like enjoy at first some of the things of God, but after you are around it and you let God do a work inside of you, all of a sudden things start to be differently on the inside of you. Like when I first really gave my life to Christ, like I didn't really still like going to church. But as I got deeper into the things of God, I realized that I love going to church. I love being around people that are worshiping God and I love it now. I didn't like reading my Bible at first because I didn't understand it. But once I started letting God do a work on the inside of me, I can't wait to read God's word now. And I didn't understand prayer because I would fall asleep when I would pray all the time and I didn't get it. Like I felt like a disappointment. But now it's like God's doing something inside of me where I love to pray. I love to spend time talking to God. It's just different. I love to worship God. I would come in and see people raising their hands at church when I was younger and laugh and be like, what are they doing? Like they're crazy. Like what's going on? And now I can't wait to lift my hands in worship and just surrender everything to God and say, God, I'm here for you. God, I worship you. It's you alone I'm here to worship. And God does a work on the inside of you. He does something deeper inside of you. And through all of this process, you begin to shine in this dark world where people look at you and they say, wow, there's something different about you and I think I like it. So how do we know if this sanctification thing is working? How do we know if God is doing a work on the inside of us? Well, Paul tells us that as well. And he says, actually, it's easy for us to see this. And he says this in chapter 2, verse 14. He says this, he goes, do everything without complaining or arguing. Wow, Paul. He really, he goes, yeah, yeah, yeah. He goes, do everything without complaining or arguing so that you can tell that the process is working in your life. Number three, if you're taking notes, you can write this down. Last point, and that is simply that we can tell that God is doing something by our conversation, by our conversation. Why is this important? What we're saying, why is it important? Well, Jesus said this in Matthew 12. He said, for the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. The heart speaks what the mouth is full of, or the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. And this is a simple principle in life because if you sit down with somebody one day and you want to know what they're really going through, just let them talk and listen. Because you'll begin to see after a while, like people can fake it for a while. We can all fake it for a season, but then after a while in a conversation, it's like our mouths, we always tell on ourselves eventually. We always begin to say something eventually where we say, here's what's really going on inside of me. Here's what I'm really feeling. This is the heart always exposes itself through words. And Paul says, listen, do everything without complaining or arguing. So the work of sanctification inside of us is understanding that all of a sudden our conversations are different than what they've ever been before. That we're doing everything without complaining or arguing. And the problem is though, for a lot of us, We feel like we're justified in our arguing and our complaining. We're like, well, Pastor, you don't understand what I'm going through. You don't understand how they did me wrong. You don't understand how my wife treats me, my husband treats me. You don't understand that neighbor should not be doing that. Like, there's the property line, and they let their dogs come over in my yard. Like, I don't get it. And my boss should not ask me to come late. They never ask anybody else, and we can complain and we can argue. But I come back to Paul, and here's Paul, you know, his ministry hopes are dashed because he's not on a stage in Rome preaching to tens of thousands of people. He's in a prison cell. He's in the worst place imaginable. He's chained up. He's in chains for being a Jesus follower. And yet he looks at and writes this letter and tells his church in Philippi, you want to know if God's doing something inside of you? You want to know if sanctification is working? He goes, then do everything without complaining or arguing. That's how you'll be able to tell if God's doing a work on the inside of us. That's how you'll be able to tell what's going on. Because in every relationship that we navigate through, if you can do that, if you can be somebody who doesn't complain, doesn't argue, man, you are gonna stand out in this world. You are truly, like we said at the beginning, shine like stars in this dark world. There'll be something about you that people like about you, but not even realize what it is. They say, wow, you're going through a hard time. You're going through a difficult situation. The boss said this, and you know, you're going through that, but wow, you're not complaining, you're not arguing. You're like there's something different here. There's something going on in your life. What is it? I like it. It's just different. You're shining like a star in this dark world. I think it's so funny because I talk to Christians all the time who say things like, oh, our world's getting so dark. Oh, our world's getting so evil. The culture, oh my goodness. Well, now is the most amazing and perfect time to shine like stars in a dark world. You want to see the world begin to change? Like, let God do a work in you so that you can shine and be different than the people around you. And Paul says, when you do this and when you live this way, what happens is verse 16, he says, you offer the teaching that gives life. So Paul says this, and listen, by the way you live your life, that you are actually teaching, you don't even have to say anything, you're just living your life, the way you're teaching other people around you who are maybe mean, who are maybe crooked, who maybe are far from God, who are maybe are Christians, who doesn't matter. He says, by the way you live your life, people are gonna see and they're gonna gain teaching that actually gives life, that actually produces the thing that we're hoping for. Paul says, listen, this is what the Christian life is all about. That when you live your life and you're not the same as everyone else, that you check your selfishness and pride at the door. You look at other people that you encounter at work or in your family, and actually you take a lower standpoint. You keep conversations on them. You think about them more than yourself. You're not the center of your universe, but instead you're lifting other people up. You believe in the best of them. You're actually saying things that speak life into them, into your kids, into your spouse, into those around you. And then all of a sudden when things aren't going the best, you know, you're letting God do a work in the inside of you, where you're watching your mouth. You're not letting just any comments slip out. You're not on Facebook bashing the world, bashing this, bashing that, but instead you're doing everything that you do without complaining or arguing, and people are going to look at you and say, oh my goodness, what, you're just different. You're just different. Like, you don't go along with the crowd. You don't take part in the things that everyone else is doing. What is the difference? What's different about you? And that's the opportunity. You can come to them and say, listen, man, I go through hard times. I go through bad situations. But in every bad time, every bad situation, you know, I'm not holding myself together, but he is holding me together. I'm a Jesus follower, and I'm trying to do this thing the best of my ability, and I want to live for Christ in all my ways and all my attitudes, and let people come around me and see that there is a God in heaven who loves them and can be there for them. There's so many people that I've contacted with, and they said, wow, I can't believe how different you are after you encounter Jesus. Like, people say to me all the time, wow, like, Jason, like you were this way in high school, and now look at you, what God's doing in your life. Like I can see that there's a God in heaven. You're not the same person you used to be. In the same time, I've talked to people in our church that will tell me that their friends and families will say, there's something different about you. Like you just seem happier. You just seem more excited. Your perspectives are changing. And they say, listen, I'm going to church now and I've encountered the love of God. I've encountered a real God and his name is Jesus. And it's all about relationship and it's changed me from the inside out. I just pray that our church should be a church that lives this way, that checks those selfishness and pride at the door, that lifts other people up and that believes the best in people, where people around us can see there's something different. I wonder if we could be that church, if we could live that way in a world that needs us so desperately to shine like stars in a dark world. Let's stand today as we close.